We will not stand down. We will not be broken. We will not be silenced. We will rise, and we will make tomorrow better than today.
That was Katie Hill, formally resigning her seat in Congress about a year ago. At the time, she was a rising star in Democratic politics and our most frequent guest here on The Issue Is. She made history as the first openly bisexual California congressman, but she stepped away from politics after a series of leaked naked photos of her emerged and after she admitted to having an affair with a campaign staffer. Hill says she is the victim of cyber exploitation. She tells her story in this new book. It's called She Will Rise, Becoming a Warrior in the Battle for True Equality, which is out this week. Katie Hill, welcome back to The Issue Is.
Hi, good to see you.
Good to see you too. I read the whole book. It's really, really great. Congratulations. I strongly recommend it. I know it's probably meant for a lot of women, but I strongly recommend it for men. I think you learn a lot in the process. So congratulations on this. And what I was so moved by was how sort of real and raw you were about a lot of things that clearly have been very traumatic to you. And sort of the premise is your husband at the time, who you were not in a great place with, said that he was going to ruin you. I'll ruin you, was the quote that he would say over and over again. And at one point in your relationship, you even considered killing yourself in the middle of the campaign. I found that so gripping to learn about.
Yeah, I mean, this was just a few weeks before the election. And, you know, I talk about that, you know, I wouldn't quite call it an attempt, but that contemplation. And that was one of the worst nights. And it was after that that I actually left him. But during that whole episode, when it was just a couple weeks before the election, that was when he first said that he'd ruin me and if I left. And so, you know, I ended up going back to him and hoping that we could just finish this thing out. And maybe once I left for D.C., and was not around as much, it would be better. And anyway, after I finally, it was 6 months in to being a member of Congress that I finally worked up the courage to say, I can't do this anymore. I've got to leave. I brought my dad with me to get my stuff. And then sure enough, I think once he realized that I was not coming back a few months later, that was when he started circulating the photos.
And those were pictures of you, some of which you didn't even know were taken of you, and also with a campaign staffer that you were involved in a consensual relationship with, which in the book you say was wrong from a power dynamic perspective. What have you learned sort of in the process of reflection over the last year about that relationship?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's so much about it, right? And there's the biggest thing comes down to that in the beginning of the campaign, it started as this just really close-knit kind of family and friendship-based dynamic where it was just a few of us. It seemed like such a long-shot campaign that, you know, I'd been a boss for a large organization before. It was never even a question that I would ever have any kind of thing with a subordinate or with somebody who worked with me. I think the intensity of the campaign, the closeness of it, plus the fact that I was having the marital trouble that I was, it all kind of created this perfect storm. And I had poor judgment, and I should never have let that happen, and I'll regret it forever. And I think the person who is the most innocent bystander, who's been hurt in all of this, is her. And I hope that she just wants to be able to start her life fresh, and I hope that she's able to do that. But you know, I think that the bottom line is that there isn't a space for this kind of thing. But and when somebody's in power, it's our responsibility to take the extra steps necessary to ensure that we aren't doing anything that can be construed as an abuse of power. But we also need to be holding other people to the same standard. And right now, you know, with Donald Trump in the White House, like, that's clearly not happening. And so when I get the criticism from, you know, other folks who say that, whatever they want to say about me. They're the same ones who defend Kavanaugh and the same ones that defend Trump on a regular basis. And so you can't help but wonder if the double standard there is, it has to do with the fact that I'm a woman or the fact that I'm a Democrat or both.
You know, in the book, you talk about the fact that your husband or those around him were threatening to release potentially hundreds of more images, and it would be a drip, drip, drip every day, which is part of the reason that you made the decision to resign. And one of the most emotional conversations you had was with one of your heroes, Nancy Pelosi, having to explain to her that you were resigning and in some ways had let her down.
Yeah, that was that was a phone call that I was dreading so much. Because, you know, the decision to step down was obviously the hardest. And I was still torn about it. And I knew that going to her and telling her what was going on, I needed to do. But she was really supportive, and she told me that I didn't need to step down and that they would have my back. But I didn't want to put her or anyone else in the Democratic caucus, and especially members of the freshman class who I was friends with, who had these tough reelection campaigns, I didn't want to put them in the position of either having to defend me or denounce me. And I didn't want, you know, my mistakes to really kind of cast a shadow on all of them. So it felt like the right thing to do and the only choice that I had at the time.
And one of the only people that was defending you was Republican Matt Gaetz, one of the most hardcore Republicans out there. He said you shouldn't resign. Talk about that relationship.
Yeah, Matt and I became friendly because we were on Armed Services together. And when, you know, the House Armed Services Committee is actually one of the most bipartisan committees, and you get a chance to actually get to know some of your Republican colleagues fairly well. And so we became friendly that way. But to be honest with you, I wouldn't even have considered us friends until after he was posting the defense of me. And it meant a lot because, you know, despite the fact that I was getting support from a number of different members of Congress, most of it was not public. Most of it was, you know, private. And I understood why it wasn't public, especially as the story was taking place. But I think the fact that he did come out so strongly, honestly, minimize some of the attacks that would have come. He's close to the president, and I think that, you know, if the president had himself tweeted about me, then it probably would have gotten that much more ugly. And I honestly feel like Matt probably had something to do with the reason he didn't, and I appreciate that greatly.
Probably the most heartbreaking part of the book, other than the death of your brother, was the image of you thinking about killing yourself after you made the decision to resign. You're in a bathtub and you're thinking, is this worth it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, this is a really devastating statistic, but more than half of victims of cyber exploitation contemplate suicide in the aftermath. And that's even higher than the number of women or the number of victims of rape who contemplate suicide. It's half for cyber exploitation, just a third for rape. And I think that it tells you something about the experience of having, you know, something so private that becomes part of the public sphere and is forever. I mean, when I'm, you know, from now on, whenever I run into somebody and they know who I am, there's a really high likelihood that they've seen those photos, even by accident. So that's just something that you kind of have to live with. And I mean, it's your career. It's the all the people who stood by you, who fought for you, who believed in you. And, you know, it truly was just the most awful several days I could imagine. And then, you know, I think what was really enlightening everything gets put into perspective is when my brother died. And at that point, it honestly became clear to me that, suicide is never going to be on the table again, because I could never do that to my parents, my mom.
When you see that there's now a Republican in your seat, Mike Garcia, do you ever regret it? I know you say you don't regret leaving, but are there moments where you're like, I could be there. He's voting the opposite way than I ever would.
Yeah, there's certainly times when, you know, I think May 12th, I believe that was the day when he won, that I was like, oh man, that was probably the hardest I thought about whether I'd made a mistake by resigning. And I sure got a lot of hate mail from people who said that I shouldn't have resigned and I cost the district and everything. I think that, the redemption will happen in November, because I think that he will have had a very short term lease on that office space. And I think, what we saw, what we learned from that election is that it was a special with incredibly low turnout. We knew that would happen. But when the turnout is that low, it benefits Republicans. It benefits them drastically. And it was the first all-male election in California at all because of COVID. It happened right during the lockdown. So a field campaign that was working on the Democratic side couldn't be effective, couldn't be knocking on doors. And so ultimately that resulted in just low voter turnout, and enough Republicans were comfortable and already aware of mail-in voting. And there was in fact a ballot collecting process that they were happily advertising at local churches. And so it's very unfortunate. I hate thinking about him being in my former office. But I do know that, I do feel good about November, because truly the district is moving in a different direction and has been for a while. Hillary Clinton won the district by 7. Right. I won the district by 9. And I know that Joe Biden's going to win the district by probably an even bigger margin, which means that, people lower down on the ticket should do well.
One of the most of your book is about getting women to get involved in politics, sort of a guidebook on how they can succeed in politics. What's the most important piece of advice you think from here?
I think the biggest piece of advice that I have is that we need every single person and woman to join in this fight for equality. And it's going to take different forms for everybody. If you feel like you can do this and have the fortitude to run for office, then we need you to do that. It's incredibly difficult, but it's so, so vital. And there are just not a lot of people who for one reason or another are able to. And so we're counting on the women who do. If you are not running for office yourself, then I think you need to be looking at everything that you can be doing to help other women get elected to office. And on top of that, the activism and the, supporting these initiatives and really educating ourselves about what are these systemic barriers that are in the way that prevent us from achieving true equality, whether that is representation in Congress or at other legislative levels, or in the boardrooms and, in any kind of leadership position, and all the way into, equal pay, into how the minimum wage, raising the minimum wage disproportionately would impact in a positive way women. And there are just so many of these issues that we need to look at through a different lens. And no one's going to lead the fight on our behalf. I mean, women are going to be the ones who have to do this. Sure. So I think that, part of a big part of the calling for the book is saying that we are, by our very nature and by the experiences that we've gone through, as women, we are warriors in this fight. And it's time for us all to stand up and to complete it.
Well, and speaking of that, some breaking news as we've been talking. Kamala Harris has been selected by Joe Biden to be the vice president. So Kamala Harris is somebody that you were one of the early endorsers of for her presidential campaign. This week we've learned she's on the ticket. She's going to accept that next week at the DNC. What do you make of the pick of Kamala Harris?
Oh, I'm so excited. I probably would have, I definitely would have preferred a Harris-Biden ticket, but I'll take the Biden-Harris ticket. And, she's been an amazing supporter of mine and just a leader in the fight for so many of these issues that matter. And I think that we will get to see just an incredible team with the two of them and taking us in the right direction. And I'm just thrilled that's the pick. It's the right one, I think, for this moment and for our country.
All right. Well, we can't let you go without having some fun, because we want to remind people of a simpler time when you got to join us in the studio. We like to play music on this show. So here is a clip of when we asked you about your favorite song and you chose the song Everybody by the Backstreet Boys. Do you do their dance move?
I don't know.
What was it? What did they do?
I can't remember.
They're already dancing. You got the whole thing ready. Stay with us. More of The Issue Is coming back. Come on. You can. Then she got into it. See it right there. We finally see the dance move.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
There was a moment.
There it is. So what do you think? So we got, it's
all
been
right,
such a...
We'll repeat that.
Yeah, it's been such a stressful time. So cue, here we go. Hit it one more time as we say goodbye. A little more Backstreet Boys. We got it. There we go. All right. Katie Hill, thanks so much for joining us. Thank everybody for watching The Issue Is. All right.